Yes. Can you hear me well? All right. So I'm Daniel. I'm from PwC. I'm the head of blockchain for EMEA. So I have a really privilege to oversee all we're doing across Europe, Middle East, and Africa. And I'm from Switzerland. So I hail from the Crypto Valley. I know there was Luca before, Oliver yesterday. And I'm going to talk to you about the wonderful emerging field of crypto finance. Now, you have heard yesterday, today, quite a lot around banking, financial services. I'm just going to wrap that up nicely, add some layers of paint, and I hope I can bring you also some new perspectives. First of all, I'd like to know, are there any bankers sitting here in the audience, active bankers today working as a banker? All right, we got one. Very brave of you, madam. Very brave. Thanks. Do we have ex-bankers, former bankers who once were in financial services and then stepped over? All right, that's the crowd. Now, first of all, I think in the crypto space, we tend to always say, like, you know, that's the old world, forget about it. This is all new, we're all doing different. I'd like to give some kudos to the bankers, the active ones, the past ones. It's a really terrible, hard job. I often compare it actually to this, to surfing. I'm a surfer myself. Any surfers in the room? All right. Switzerland's famous for surfing, isn't it? So what's special about surfing? Surfing is risky. It's dangerous. You need to get wet. It's not something you can learn watching YouTube videos or reading any paper manuals. It's hard work. And it's something you need to get very proficient at, and it takes a long time to master. And I think banking, financial services is very similar in that. I think, you know, doing a payment point to point, that's very simple, but that's not just banking. Everyone herein knows this is a very complex business. So I think, you know, bankers have been doing that now for quite some long time. They're mastering it. They're surfing. They're sometimes duck diving, sometimes riding the waves. But let's look forward now in this, what is this crypto finance about? I'll show you a typical day in the life of a surfing banker a few days ago. Lovely beach, beautiful swell, couple of waves coming in. They always come in sets. But this is a great beach. Every surfer will really get excited looking at this. And for those who are familiar with some of these acronyms, just a huge bunch of different regulation that comes at, you know, in waves and that somehow needs to get passed over, surfed. You know, you need to master this. This is a typical day in life of a banker surfing. And I think the whole industry has been pretty good at that. I mean, that's really a skill they built up. But that's the past, right? How does the wave check, I'm checking the wave in the morning, how does the picture look today and in the future? More like this. And what we're looking at, of course, are new disruptive technologies, and it's not just blockchain. Yeah, blockchain is one of them, but I mean, obviously, there's others, you know, artificial intelligence. What we just heard, IoT is going to make things incredibly complex with all these micropayments. Who's going to take care of that? Is it the finance world or someone else? Drones going to fly around us. The robots want to pay maybe for something. How are they going to do that? It's going to get pretty interesting with all these exponential technologies. I'm brainwashed. I attended the Singularity University, so I really love everything's exponential. So blockchain is one of them. It's going to make things incredibly even more complex. So the surfer is going to get tested. And what I think what we need to do jointly as a crypto community, the blockchain community, is kind of redefine what I call the crypto finance in the future. I'm going to give you a very simple model to see how I think about that. Obviously, starting point for crypto finance, I call this the crypto triangle. Think of a, you know, simple triangle. The blockchain, obviously, is the starting point. It somehow needs to work on the blockchain. But then there's something that my clients, I work a lot, of course, with incumbent banks, fund managers, hedge funds. What they're super excited about is the thing on the right-hand side, the tokenization of assets. I mean, many, many things in the next far, very near future will move from the physical world into the digital world, virtualization and tokenization of assets. That's going to be real, but maybe also virtual assets, rights. I mean, the whole thing that we did around securitization can be done with tokenization of assets. It's going to be efficient, cheap, collateralizable. This is really great. I mean, most of the financial services community gets super excited about that one. That one is a bit different, right? We've all been there. Crypto finance, starting with ICOs, cryptocurrencies, is still a bit of a difficult piece. But that's going to also be very, very fundamental in the crypto finance world. This is basically where it all comes together. I'll show, I mean, I'm not going to talk about blockchain. I always like to show that slide because it's kind of plays to the Swiss part in me. Blockchain, we all know, is a large tool, a Swiss army knife. This is a big tourist version where you have a lot of tools. I think it's fair to say we haven't really checked out all the tools. We haven't really seen all the uses for this. We probably have opened about one or two blades or functional tools here. And there's a lot more going to come to life. And of course, financial services is going to get transformed through it, you know, central banking, repo business, Nostro Lower, and all these things. Tokenization of assets, just an example from Switzerland, diamonds. They get laser screened. This is also a picture from a startup in London. Many do that, Everledger. So diamonds on a blockchain, it excites bankers really, really strongly. And now the tokenization and the blockchain coming together in a crypto finance, and this is what I think is going to happen, and we're all kind of part of that journey. Everyone here in the room is probably playing in one area of this. I've deliberately not taken ICOs on here because ICOs factually is more of a, you know, funding mechanism that plays part of here, but fundamentally it starts on the left-hand side with payments. Of course, you'll have lending. Then you have trading brokerage, which is today already happening. We saw a couple of really good presentations up here that talked about exchanges, the future of exchanges. We need to up the game on exchanges. The current world with very low liquidity causes volatility. So this is going to be a key area of crypto finance to grow in the future. Out of that will spring a multitude of innovative things, derivatives, future swaps. We can do a lot of things. Fund solutions. Personally, I know of 21 really good crypto fund projects kind of setting up, going live, launching. Imagine now you're a wealth manager and you've been coming to the derivative fund solution arena. It's a very small step, and this will happen, I predict it. A small step to say, well, I can actually do portfolio management for you. I can build you a very nice portfolio, a bit of tokenized assets, a few cryptocurrencies, a few other things we're going to put in the mix, and it's going to be a distributed, decentralized, so to say, portfolio that hopefully has low correlation with amongst each other. It's something we need to work on as an industry, and that will lead ultimately to a discipline that I would call, well, it's crypto wealth management. And of course, people that use wealth management today, they will very unlikely say, I want to move all my money, all my wealth fully into crypto. Maybe people in the room, we will do that, but many out there won't. And they won't do that in 3 years and in 5 years. But increasingly, they will see this as an alternative asset class, right? Like there are alternative asset classes today. And I think crypto finance will earn a spot in that field and probably add a lot of value, particularly also in the third world, where all these beautiful things here, this is a first world product portfolio, right? This is something that north of the equator, we're pretty good at, you know, in the US, in the UK, in Europe, in Asia, but there's big parts in the world that are excluded from many of these products, and they will never have an easy access to this. Crypto finance can pave the way to make all these things, the whole curve, accessible to those. And I think this is what I'm personally, I mean, I spent probably 17, 18 years in the banking financial services field, doing traditional stuff, doing fintech stuff, and now in the last couple of years, blockchain projects. I think this is what really excites me. And I think it's like a little journey that we all need to come play together, and every element needs to be in place. What are some of the key imperatives? I'm just sharing what I learned in the last maybe 12 months. I think surfing the blockchain, we all know this blockchain is a very emotional topic. Which blockchain, which technology is going to win ultimately? I'm agnostic. I think, you know, it's going to be multiple blockchains in the future. You know, we'll, as we have different car brands driving on the streets, we just want to get from A to B. And sometimes I want to do it extremely fast. And sometimes I want to carry a lot of things with me in the back. And sometimes I have a family with 8 people. I need to fit them in a car. A Lamborghini, a 2-seater will not do the job. So I will choose my brand or my car. And the cars will evolve over time. They will have better machines, be more energy efficient, have maybe, I don't know, an additional tire or a spare tire, or I don't know. So we should look at this a bit maybe less emotional. And I think what the finance world, the old one, but hopefully also the new one, really care about is stability. The whole crypto finance thing will go down miserably if we're not able to provide stability to the blockchain. Governance, comes with stability, but very important. People want to know who's in charge and who can tweak around and who's actually tweaking. And functionality, so what is possible, what can you do with it? So these, for me, are the three main things that's going to drive as levers the transition to crypto finance. On the tokenization of assets, I think wealth management, asset management is going to be probably the most interesting thing once we are there, but we're very far away. Today, if I'm illiterate with crypto, who's going to advise me? Where do I get advice? There are a lot of people, probably wrong advisors, or I read online, I get confused. This will be the new advisory where people will be competent and get the advice they need. And then when we talk infrastructure, what I learned, not being I'm a strategist, so what I learned is that small details can matter tremendously, like accounting, tax. You would be very interested to hear all the discussions that are currently happening at the global level in the IFRS working group. There's a US GAAP working group. And they're asking themselves very fundamental questions. If I have a bunch of tokens, how do I put them normally into my P&L? How do I put them into my books? Are they off balance sheet, on balance sheet? In what case? Do I need to put capital against that? These are so fundamental questions. They're gonna change the face of this crypto finance fundamentally, and they will switch the appetite that the industry has to build out the crypto finance also tremendously. These are the things happening right now. So how does the accounting tax regime work? Of course, custody, never-ending story. We need proper custody solutions, not just for us people, but also how to transfer this. If I die tomorrow in a car crash, there needs to be a transfer mechanism that someone can access these keys. If you want someone to validate if something is there, you cannot just hand him or her the key over, right? And maybe you still have the root password for that key or for those assets. Well, you can give them, you rewire, and you just... So there are a couple of fundamental questions we need to solve around custodianship. And then obviously one of the biggest impediments and something we've been hearing here on stage for the last 2 days, the liquidity market making function. That I think the number we had before here was, I don't know, 20 trillion versus 2.4 billion or 8 billion. I mean, it's still huge. We need to have liquidity in the market. We need to have these market makers, institutional market makers. And once we have that, you know, the whole thing will really become more stable, volatility will go away, and a lot of the business models that we think about today will become possible. So if it's me, I would say these are the three imperatives, but these are, again, just building blocks of the entire crypto finance. But I think we should look joyfully into the future. It's a great time to be here. It's a great time just sitting in this room because we are literally at the forefront of this crypto finance economy, and I'm also very, very honored to be part of that. And when I speak with colleagues who know nothing about what we spoke here the last 1.5 days, you can feel that they are slowly wondering whether they're missing out on something. But no matter where we're going to end up on a journey, no matter what's going to happen, you know, how the crisis develops, I think this is here to stay. Crypto finance will evolve. How it's going to evolve, we will see, and everyone here can play its special part in that. And a nice saying I brought from Hawaii is, you know, there's a million ways to serve. Just keep smiling and everything is all right. There's not the right way in this game. So I hope this a bit surf-inspired theme was also entertaining you. So very happy to speak after this and hope to see many of you at the networking lunch.
Thank you.
Thank you.